great, baby, yeah!
This is a film that comes from 97. It's a big parody of Bond, of lots of stylish films that came out in the 60s. And Mike Myers is just camping it up to the, you know, to the max. That suit's ridiculous.
Well, surprisingly, somebody's done their research. I think there's a moment around 66, 67 in London where this kind of extreme form of menswear, just in a couple of streets, is outrageous. So, in that sense, it's not so far-fetched, I don't think.
Oh, behave. Yeah.
So, suits like that were actually available for men in the 60s to buy, but not only that, they wore them.
A few men wore them. I think it became known as the sort of peacock style, the kind of swinging London look.
Hold that.
If you were a young man in swinging 60s in London, you bought a suit like that, what's the sort of message? What are you trying to say about you as a person?
Well, I think you're saying that you're kind of kicking against the establishment. You know, this is not a suit for the office job. This is a suit for going out to the new London clubs. It's a suit for engaging with the new street culture of London and engaging with the now. It means you're hyper fashionable.
Psychedelic, dandified boutiques and tailors like Mr. Fish and Granny Takes a Trip launched the Peacock Revolution.
There's a sense of the kind of Edwardian or late Victorian dandy about this sort of costume, or even the Regency buck, that the period they really liked, the 60s designer, was the early 19th century, the kind of Regency dandy. There's a sort of madness about it, I think.
Nothing was off limits, and 60s designers used all sorts of unusual materials to steal the suit back from the establishment.
Daddy wasn't there to take me to the fair. It seemed he doesn't care.
It looks like he's wearing a curtain.
It does, but you know, the researcher has done their work. We've a suit by Mr. Fish in the V&A's collection that's not so dissimilar. Those sorts of designers were taking furniture fabrics and turning them into suits. It's only permissible within the middle of London and other urban centres. It loses its power and becomes rather dangerous when it moves outside of that sort of terrain. There's a lot of nervousness about the way that men are growing their hair, are turning into women, essentially.
I think it's disgusting, disgraceful, and effeminate.
I can't tell one from the other.
Well, I think they're a load of puffs.
Do you think it was a particularly worrying time for those people because the suit, historically, is so synonymous with masculinity,
yeah,
that to see that change, it's like, oh my God, this is, you know, everything we know and understand is being taken away from us.
Yeah, social conservatives were, you know, shaking in their shoes.
If the row of long-haired, weedy youths you pictured are British manhood 1967, then God help this country.
Things are loosening up in the 60s. Ways of being a man are shifting. So you've got the decriminalisation of homosexuality. It's a time of new freedoms. So in an interesting way, I think men's clothes reflect those broader changes in terms of fashion generally. So there's this technicolour moment when men's fashion changes from the monochrome, you get these incredibly bright colours, new textures, new inspiration, and then it goes again by, you know, 68, 69.
So very brief then.
Yeah.